afternoon. Thanks for tuning in. You're watching Countdown on Bloomberg Quint Live, India's first digital live streaming business news service. I'm Navneet Saluja D'Souza. Well, these are the top headlines that we're tracking at this hour. Markets gain momentum after a subdued start. The Nifty gains around the 11,900 mark. Auto and FMCG stocks are underperforming. The PSU banking index continues to gain for the second straight day. All but one constituent are trading with gains. Telecom stocks are outperforming yet again. Bharti Airtel and Infratel are the top Nifty gainers, while Vodafone Idea has nearly doubled since its earnings announcement. And SBI Life sees its biggest one-day fall in 8 months after 2.7% of its equity exchange hands in a large deal today. Good afternoon, Devina. Some traction seen. We are building up momentum owing to the banking stocks once again.
And Reliance Industries, Navneet. Today, the big pop that's come in from Reliance Industries clearly supporting the index. And we come to get you a sense of the point contributions at the start of the show as well. So this is what the index snapshot looks like. So it looks like we're moving somewhere in today's session after that lull over the last 1 week. So as you can see, Reliance Industry, taking the bulk of the weight in today's session. 39 points contribution coming only from Reliance Industries. Following that, you have obviously HDFC Bank 8 points and Bharti Airtel contributing another 11 odd points. So it's Reliance Industries, and on the flip side, ICICI Bank takes a breather and you've got some weakness coming into the IT stocks. But coming straight to the heat map then, and we talk about the broader market space as well, which seems to be underperforming in today's session. But this is the mid cap and the small cap index absolutely flat for the Nifty mid cap 100, small cap index in tow with what the benchmark index has been doing. The broader market space, the advanced decline ratio almost at power, so there's not too much of a direction that you can gauge from here. There's been a tussle on two or three occasions, but it's somewhat now converging towards the end of the trading session. Coming to the heat map then, and on the index, what's making its big moves? Like we've said, we have big contributions coming in from Reliance Industries, though that comes in at the fourth place in terms of percentage gains. Bharti Infratel and Bharti Airtel take the top two slots. Axis Bank is up about 3% odd. Then you've got the likes of a Power Grid. Grasim does well on the back of some positive news coming from the telcos as well. IndusInd Bank, Tech Mahindra and Titan Industries up about 0.5% odd today. What's losing out? The biggest loser, Yes Bank, down about 3.5% odd. Following that is Z, TCS, M&M, Auto, IT and FMCG as a pocket looking weak. So HUL is also down about 1% odd in today's trade. Coming to the broader market space, we'll quickly run you through the movers. Get the MRR going for the Nifty mid-cap index. Oriental Bank of Commerce is up about 16% odd. I think following that should be Corporation Bank also, which is doing well. So all your PSU banks, as you can see, have stacked up with gains of anywhere between 4% to 16% all the way up there. Amongst the losers, Edelweiss takes a breather, is down about 3.9%. Following that is Glenmark, so profit taking on both of these counters. Then you've got Info Edge as well, which has run up quite significantly post its numbers. The stock's corrected a bit. And then you've got the likes of GMR Infra, Rajesh Exports, Indiable Ventures, which is looking weak. Coming to the small cap index and a quick run through of that as well. Andhra Bank, Syndicate Bank, again, it's the banks that's taking the top slot. Just Dial comes up as well, about 6% odd higher. Delta Corp is doing well. And Dr. Lal Path Labs, once again, looks strong. Coming to the losers, Walkhard is down. JK Lakshmi Cement is down. Suzlon, Care Ratings and Raymond is down about 1.5% in today's session. But also keep an eye out on what's been happening in the futures and options space. Navneet is here to highlight that for us. Navneet.
Thanks for that, Devina. More of action lies on the stock futures side, but nevertheless banking stocks which are in focus. So we've seen Nifty, as you can see on your screen, premium may have gone up from 27-28 points to 43 points right now, but Bank Nifty is the one where major action lies, 14% higher in terms of OI buildup as we speak. Remember yesterday we were highlighting how Wix had inched higher despite of markets remaining flat, but today some bit of cool off definitely seen for India Wix, which is at 15.5. In terms of options data, 11,800 to 12,000 was the range that we were talking about. Convincingly, now I think for majority of the session, we've traded above the mark of 11,000. In fact, when we started the day, there was a lot of called writing which came in on 11,900 and the 12,000 strike. But after the index crossed that mark, traded above it at least for an hour, intraday unwinding has come in now for 11,900 as well as the 12,000 strike. There was a time when both these strikes had added nearly 10 lakh shares, and 11,000 put right now has added about about 18 lakh shares. So aggressive riding seen around that level. The next level, of course, the street will be watching out will be the psychological mark of 12,000. Moving on to the individual stock futures, then Bharti Airtel, of course, telcos have been in focus. We highlighted how Reliance has been contributing to Nifty gains today. So 17% higher in terms of OI buildup, telling you there are fresh long positions coming here for the third straight day now. Also, put writing has been seen at 420 level. The stock has been trading above that. Let's see if that becomes a support now. And 47% of the traded quantity for Bharti Airtel has been marked for delivery. Remember, last 2 days when the stock was moving higher, deliverable quantity was just about 18%. Now, when the news has come, they will be going in for tariff hike from the month of December. We are seeing delivery-based buying coming in for Bharti Airtel. Castrol is the other one. It's in focus. We usually don't discuss the stock. HSBC has hiked the target price. It's up on high volumes. Also, the futures witnessing fresh long position. Lastly, watch out for Tata Elxsi too, which has breached its 200-day moving average. The stocks, I guess, come off the high point of the day. It was up 4 to 4.5%. Now, just up 2.5%. But futures indicating a huge amount of build-up. OI is up about 26%, Davina.
All right. So those are the stocks to keep an eye out on. Also, let's begin with our market conversation with Saurabh Gupta of Quantum Mutual Fund. He's joining us right now on the show. Saurabh, thanks very much for taking out the time. A pretty directionless market over the last 1 week, somewhat restricted in a very narrow band. But what's the overall sentiment gauge? Does the structure still look like it's got legs to take it further beyond 12,000?
Look, so what we are seeing is that it's a very unusual thing that the market is at all-time high wherein the GDP growth is at 10-year low. So it's a very unusual thing that is happening in the markets. And from a Sensex perspective, yes, it appears that things are not going in the right direction because it should reflect what is happening in the broader economy. But if you look at broader markets, there are definitely quite a pockets of pain that are emerging and some of the sectors are really not doing well and reflecting the fundamentals of the economy. So our broad sense is that this rally in the index is driven by very few stocks in a narrower index, further narrower rally. So one has to be careful and not be very upbeat on what's happening in the market purely driven by liquidity and not by earnings growth or improvement in macro fundamentals.
You advise taking fresh bets and a larger quantum of bets in terms of making equity market investments right now?
No, I think one should be very, very careful and one has to be very, very cautious and has to focus on stock-specific ideations wherein the valuations have become attractive in few of the sectors and few of the names. But broadly, we don't believe that the markets are factoring in the kind of pain that is happening in the broader economy at 5% of GDP growth. When last time we were growing at 5% GDP growth, markets were the valuations were very, very attractive at that point in time. But there is clearly nothing of that sort happening right now. One has to be very careful about creating a portfolio of good names because the valuations are real, real high for some of the names which are driving the stock price, driving the index right now. So one has to be very careful right now.
Saurabh, your assessment of the earnings season then, a lot of market experts have been highlighting it's been better. Of course, let's not talk about the bottom line, which was boosted because of corporate tax rate cut. Overall, the earnings growth for Nifty, do you think after the September quarter, we're in for a better second half?
Doesn't look like definitely there will be some base effect that will play out because this round of slowdown in the economy has started to happen in the previous second half post the IL&FS crisis. So there could be some base effect that is happening and the expectations are also tapered down. But we don't see the growth which should reflect in the stock prices. For example, the stock price clearly reflect much higher growth than what actually the growth would be in the second half also. And when we meet companies and corporates, nobody is seeing that kind of growth or improvement in economy or a V-shaped recovery that is happening. Even if there is a recovery, it's albeit very, very slow and very, very narrow. So clearly, the markets are moving beyond fundamentals right now, according to us.
Okay, so which are the pockets which, according to you guys, can still give you returns of, let's say, 10 to 15% in the next 1 year in terms of sectors?
Yeah, clearly, Yeah, so we'll talk about 1.5-2 years. What we believe is that auto is one of the sectors which has reflect wherein the stock prices have reflected the pains that is in the broader economy and the kind of slowdown that the economy is seeing and the auto sales are seeing. So auto is one pocket where the valuations have become attractive. Then within building materials, you can find names which are below replacement cost, very strong ROE, good balance sheet, and other things. So this is second. Thirdly, good strong NBFCs where they don't face liability side issues which others are facing, but have been beaten down because everything is getting beaten down by the name of NBFC. So these are 3-4 pockets wherein one can pick up some good names and can create a portfolio from 3-5 years perspective and create wealth in the range of what you talked about kind of returns.
The banking space, especially the banks which had exposure to SR Steel case, now that a favorable verdict has come in favor of Committee of Creditors, do you feel then the December quarter or the second half earnings could be better considering the provision write back, the sort of recoveries these banks will make, because most of them have made provision of between 50-100%, and they are also indicating whatever recovery comes in, that will directly be flowing into the P&L account?
Look, so what our sense is that I think most of us and or the sell side or anybody who is looking at the banks were thinking that in FY20 there will be write backs or recoveries that would be coming through SR or through other recovery mechanisms and NCLT solutions. So for FY20 it is already baked in. Yes, it did not come in H1, so it will come in H2. So that should be a positive, but from a yearly perspective, I don't see it as a positive surprise, because whatever interactions that I have had, we have seen that this was already getting factored in for the full year earnings. So quarter, which quarter it would fall, this would not be that important if you are looking things from a 1 year perspective. But yeah, this was about to happen. The timing was uncertain, but the timing has become certain now, so that is a positive.
Sort of at this point, from an investment standpoint, while we've already seen a lot of money coming into these larger corporate facing private banks, is it the turn for PSU banks to get that kind of attention? And probably not all of them, but you know, the biggest one being SBI, and we've heard the management say that there are 3 big resolutions that's going to happen, and that's obviously going to be a big kicker for them.
Yes, so this recovery and this SR ruling that has come from Supreme Court does help the corporate lenders, and SBI being one of them and one of the larger ones. We believe that within PSUs, the largest PSU, SBI is the only name, credible name, which has a strong liability size franchise, good credible management because it's homegrown management, not imported from other banks. So that's the name that one can bet upon. Rest of the PSUs are more of cyclical play, where you play on the cycle, either on the rate cycle or the credit cycle, and you exit at the right time. So these are not stories where you can hold for 3-5 years perspective, besides SBI. Private banks is a place where the risk mechanism or the business fundamentals are much, much superior, but most of that has been factored in the valuations. So one. Getting fresh position at these valuations would be a little risky. That's what our sense is. But yes, from within the PSU bank, the largest one is a name that one could think along to play around this cycle right now.
All right, got that. SBI though right now is now the high point of the day. It's at 328, up 1.2%. So I'll leave it at that. Thank you very much for joining us this afternoon. And moving on to our next topic of discussion, let's talk about the road sector. The hybrid annuity model, or HAM, has grown substantially over the last 3 years, according to Crisil Research. However, smaller developers are finding financial closure elusive, and overage projects are facing termination risk. Let's discuss all of this with Hetal Gandhi. She's the director at Crisil Research and joining us right now on the show. Hetal, thanks very much for taking out the time. You know, going through your report, obviously, we have seen the progression of these HAM projects, and now the likelihood of them contributing to about 45-50% of all NHAI projects is what you are predicting. Aside from that, the fact that most of the bigger names have achieved financial closure, the smaller ones are hitting a roadblock. Talk to us about that.
Yes, I think somewhere around FY15, FY16, government had taken up this big step of introducing the hybrid annuity model, and that was the step in the right direction, given that it was reducing the amount of money that government had to contribute in construction of roads. Prior to that, almost 2 years, we were doing almost everything on EPC. From that to today, we have come up a long way. In the last 2 to 3 years, almost 30% of the highways which were being constructed in the country were under the HAM mode. And we believe that almost 50% of the construction that is expected to happen over the next 2 to 3 years, including FY20, would be on the HAM mode. So a great progress, almost 6,670 kilometers which have been awarded. But there are certain concerns which are coming up, mainly in line with achieving financial closures as well as appointed dates. We believe appointed dates is a larger worry than the financial closures part of it. And there's a reason for that. If you look at the total data on kilometers, almost 75 to 80% of the projects have achieved financial closures. A larger proportion of the projects who have not achieved financial closures are the ones which are awarded in FY18. A few of them have also moved or crossed the 15-month mark, and these players would be predominantly the smaller ones who have consolidated revenues of less than 1,500 crores. If financial closures happen, then they would be at a higher cost for these developers. But wherever financial closures have been achieved as well, appointed dates is a big worry. So all roughly 2,500 kilometers where appointed dates need to be there, and more than 50% of them have crossed the 18-month mark. And that is what, some remains a monitorable for the sector. We believe that the focus is going to shift from awarding of road projects to execution of road projects. If you look at the first 6 months, awarding has been pretty tepid, only 1,000 kilometers which has got awarded. There is a good amount of tendering pipeline which exists, and you will need to see a lot of aggression in awarding to ensure that the targets which were being set up at the beginning of the year are actually achieved.
So is there an issue that you see right now with some of the smaller players that are bidding aggressively but are not being able to get that kind of financial closure?
I would not say that bidding is aggressive, but given that they are smaller players who have been predominantly active in the EPC space, do not have enough amount of experience in executing a PPP kind of a model or the HAM kind of a model, they would take relatively a longer period of time. Expectation from the lending community would clearly be that if at all they have bid below NHAI project cost, then they bring a more amount of equity into the project to ensure that the risk levels of the money that is being lent remains stable. And that is what is the obstacle. I think the bigger worry is, the land acquisition data that gets published. And if we have looked at tenders of all the projects which have been awarded, and if you look at the tendering data of 2018, you will see that at the time of tendering, your 3D and 3G stage land acquisition had dropped substantially. You were at almost 50% land acquisition as compared to 88% land acquisition 3 years back. And that is where the focus should be now, to ensure that land is in place and whatever has been awarded is being provided appointed dates, and then the execution takes place.
Okay, so according to your report, you're saying about 2,540 kilometers of the 6,670 kilometers of awarded HAM projects are awaiting appointment date, and over 60 to 65% of that 2,540 kilometers are running a risk of termination, which have exceeded 18 odd months. What does that do to the overall target of putting out projects, and how execution will likely take place, and the execution target cutoff point that they have?
So we believe that execution this year will be flattish, which is equal to what you did last year. And there is a downward risk to that, because for that, the progress has to be faster. If you look at the beginning of the HAM project, almost 350 kilometers that have got completed till now under HAM, you saw actually a lot of projects that also got completed before time. That would go into risk. You will start seeing delays creeping up if appointed dates do not happen on time, and which is where the termination risk comes. Now, if termination happens, the developer doesn't have anything to lose, but the authority will go through the entire process of rebidding that project, which would only increase the time that you are going to take to construct the same number of kilometers of road. So that's where, from a overall growth point of view, it is important that termination doesn't happen.
Hetal, just want to get a sense, what's the prerequisite and what is the reason for delay in appointed date? That comes to the government, right?
Yes. So you have to have more than 80% land in place at specific stages to ensure that you are able to provide appointed date.
Okay, so it's only related to land acquisition, and which smaller players, according to you, have not been able to get that acquisition in time?
No, financial closure, if we are talking about, it is more inclined where the smaller players are not able to get financial closures. But if we are talking about appointed dates and land acquisition, it is spread across.
That's meant even for the larger players. Give us a sense then, of course, this was started in 2016, and if it's a HAM project, 40% of the funding does come from NHAI, remaining 60% the developer has to bring in the funds, and it can be in the form of equity or raising debt. Where is the problem going at the time of the bidding? They're not just able to raise debt, or there's lack of capital also with the company?
We believe that it is more an issue of getting the right terms when they are trying to get debt on board. So if they bring about more equity, then the financiers would be fine to give them at a lower debt equity ratio. So that is what is resulting into delay in financial closures.
Since you are expecting the share of HAM projects will be moving higher in the coming years as well for these NHAI projects, do you then feel companies with stronger balance sheet will emerge out as winners and the company with not so stronger balance sheet will go in for EPC projects?
Yes, clearly we see that, and we have seen that in fact that bidding which has happened in FY19, as well as that's happening this year, you are seeing lesser number of players actually participating, which is mostly getting done by the larger players. So we are clearly going to see that shift.
Hetal, one last question. You've also in your report suggested around 40% of the projects that have been bid, which have been priced in at 10% below lowest tender or L1 of NHAI cost, has come in from the smaller players, while the majority of the larger players have been in 10% higher than NHAI cost. Is that also a marker of differential?
So typically what happens is it depends upon what is the kind of competition for a project that you have bid out for. If the number of players for bidding for a particular stretch are lesser, and you are seeing only large players participating, your tendency to go overboard and bid below NHAI cost becomes lesser. And if you are a new guy who is trying to enter into the market, then you may get aggressive and you may bid below NHAI cost. We believe that the current situation is way better than what it was 5 years back, where the bidding used to be extremely aggressive. Today, we will not classify the bidding as extremely aggressive, but there is a lot of caution in the market, and therefore anything that is bid below NHAI cost does get questioned. So that in a way then becomes a bottleneck in terms of, what were the reasons that you bid below NHAI cost, and then therefore, what is the kind of debt equity ratio at which we will offer you debt.
All right. And one last question. In total, you're expecting the awarding of all HAM, EPC and BOT road projects to moderate in, fiscal from 2020 to 2022 as compared to 2017 to 2019, which was about 14,000 kilometers or?
Correct. So we are definitely seeing a significant moderation in awarding. As I mentioned, for NHAI, the first half of fiscal 20, we have seen only 1,000 kilometers which have been bid out. We are seeing active tenders of almost 3,500 to 3,800 kilometers. So ideally, what we are expecting is they can do anywhere between 4,500 kilometers to be awarded, which is significantly lower than what they did last year. Execution, because the focus is on execution and on ensuring that the land is in place and therefore the execution pumps in, we believe they might still be able to complete execution of same number of kilometers as they did last year, close to 3,500 to 3,700.
Okay, Hetal, we leave it at that. Thank you very much for joining us this afternoon. So that's Crisil's report suggesting that in 2023 to 2022, almost 50% of all the projects that will be awarded by NHAI will be through the HAM route, though obviously they are focusing more on executions now rather than project awarding. Moving on, Dalal and Brocha is one of the legacy brokerages in the country, and Milind Karmarkar is someone who's been heading the portfolio management services for over 10 years at the firm. A chartered accountant by training, he manages about 900 crores of investors' money in the markets. Neeraj, he spoke to him on our special series Navigating Through Uncertainty to find out what he makes of the high valuations being commanded by some of the consumer-facing stocks. Here's what he had to say.
When you are looking at these type of stocks, which are predominantly, frankly, into consumption, predominantly, I won't say all, but predominantly into consumption, and probably the reason why they are doing well is that the opportunity in consumption is massive. Like as I was saying, that in last 30-35 years, GDP has grown 65 times, and stock market has grown 135 times. It's simple maths that you have a 12%, say 7% GDP growth, 5% inflation, 12% nominal growth. So any good business working in this environment has to grow at about 25% higher than that. That is what market has given. So if you look at consumption as a sector, and when I'm saying consumption, I don't restrict myself to only FMCG or consumer discretionary, but I would say it ranges right from stocks, I mean the sectors which we discussed, which is discretionary, non-discretionary. They could also include consumer goods, they could include FMCG, they include, but I think one should also include financials like banks, non-banking financial companies. One can include pharma, one can include hospitals. There are new sectors like insurance. So these are, these can be extremely powerful growth drivers. So that is the reason why I think consumption per se, because the opportunity is massive. Like the other day, my driver came to me. And so he's an Uber driver, but he takes me to office every day. And I was just asking him, what did he do during, Sunday? So he said, I took my wife out to Juhu. So I said, did you take your car? So he said, yes, I took my car. I didn't take the bike. So I asked him why. So he says, no, I have not taken the insurance. I mean, I have not renewed the insurance, and now the fines are high. So effectively, you go back 6-8 months, these insurance guys were cribbing that in two-wheelers, no one renews insurance. But that is happening. So the opportunity in these cases are massive. Like I was talking to my team and I was asking them how many of them have insured their house. And interestingly, none of them had. So the opportunity there can be massive. So whether it's insurance, finance, pharmaceuticals, hospitals. So there are a lot of places where consumption can make a play. So if you move from 2000 to 6000, the kind of growth which can come in these sectors can be massive.
Okay, so this $2,000 to $6,000 per capita, $2,000 to $6,000 per capita income, viewers, and Milind is really optimistic and bullish. There are people who are probably talking about first moving from $2,000 to maybe $3,500, $4,000, and then post that. There are two things that will happen, right? One is people who do not have access to a particular good or service.
Correct.
Will make use of that.
Absolutely.
And then people who have a particular good or service will go to the premium end.
Very true.
Now, within the investable universe, where is it that you find favor? I'm guessing the answer is everywhere, but still there would be some where you believe the winners would be more pronounced.
I think finance could be a very interesting area. So finance and banking probably has not moved up in last 10 years, if you see that, more or less. I mean, as I said, that not moving is going down significantly. So that can be a huge opportunity, because as your per capita income moves up, the demand for finance also goes up. As it is, we are saying most of the banks are growing because of retail loans. And I think that will continue. Insurance is another sector. So banking and finance would be somewhere where I would think that interesting things could happen. long-term big growth is possible there.
You think growth will take care of the punchy valuations that some of these seem to be trading at currently?
Yes, I think so. It's very simple. I'll give you, take a stock which trades at say 60 times, okay? But if it can grow at 24% year on year, in three years, the valuation comes down to roughly about 30 times. And in another 3 years, it comes down to about 13, 14 times. So that's what it is.
Okay. So you believe that this punchy price to book, I mean, I'm not saying you own these names, but I'm just using them as illustrative examples. That HDFC Bank, for example, at about 3.5, 4, whatever your assumptions, maybe or a Bajaj Finance at post QIP, maybe 7, yeah. 8, 9, whatever your assumptions again. Those are not punchy simply because there is a trajectory of growth for the next 4 or 5 years.
Absolutely. Another thing happens, which is more of a financial engineering there, that these companies typically, I mean, I don't want to argue whether it's right or wrong, but they come out with QIPs time and again, because for all these companies, cash is raw material. And they come out with the current market value. So that effectively brings down their price to book ratio also. That is what has happened earlier in many other names. And I think that will continue to happen.
Well, you can watch as well as read this entire interview on our website, BloombergQuint.com. Okay, let's move on and address the markets. We're holding firmly above the mark of 11,900 at 9:30 is where index is trading. Remember, majority of the contribution today is coming from Reliance, while the banking index is once again outperforming. It's 230 points higher for the Nifty Bank, trading around the levels of 31-32. Good time to bring in our technical experts on board and take their strategies on the markets. Amar Singh of Angel Broking joins us, and also we've got Sachdanan Utekar of TradeWorld. Good afternoon to both of you gentlemen. Amar, let me come to you. We were trading in a very tight range for last two sessions, and today for majority of the session at least, we've traded above the mark of 11,900. Would you take any fresh bet on the upside?
Yeah, I would say that we've been bullish on the Nifty for quite some time now, and also if you look at the charts on the short term, I would say the daily charts are clearly pointing that there is some sideways trend, but the positive uptrend definitely remains in place. And the weekly charts are extremely strong. What we are seeing on the monthly charts is, yes, the earlier highs which Nifty had made, 12,700, I'm talking the futures contract, 12,070 or so, 12,100, that's a crucial zone of resistance. Whereas on the downside, 11,800 is a crucial support zone. So we are seeing it trade in this range, but yes, the dips are being bought into, and you rightly said it's some of the few stocks like Reliance which have powered the way today. But overall, I would say that the bias remains positive, so dip should be used as a buying opportunity. Trading consistently above 12,100 mark could then lead to the next phase of rally.
Okay, so buy on dips is the call coming in from Amar Singh. Sachdanan, the bulls have been writing the 11,900 put quite aggressively today. Almost 17 to 18 lakh shares have been added there. Would you also build a long position around the current levels, or Bank Nifty, which has been outperforming in the last few sessions, is looking attractive?
Well, good afternoon, Amit. In fact, yes, the observations are right. But if you look at Nifty, you know, it is still in that consolidation mode. But if you look at Bank Nifty, you know, it has managed to surpass its previous weekly swing high. So, you know, definitely, you know, the strength is very much evident in when it comes to Bank Nifty. And I think the outperformance should continue going forward. So definitely, you know, on the long side, but I would prefer, you know, trading this particular move through Bank Nifty. So 31,100 should be the stop loss for Bank Nifty. And what we are expecting is that this particular momentum that has been generated in today's session and the kind of stocks that are participating in Bank Nifty today, I think we definitely could see a headroom right up to say 31,450, 600 in the coming days. So a bullish call on Bank Nifty would be prudent right now. Looking at the wave structure, I think Bank Nifty looks more confident. So 31,100 would be the stop loss.
Okay, let's talk about individual stocks then. Sachdanan, I'll keep it with you.
Well, going ahead, we like the structure of MGL. You know, we have already seen the stock has been in a very healthy secular uptrend. Recently, we saw it breaking out from another continuation pattern, which is a bullish pennant. If you look at today's OI additions, that have been really significant again. We are expecting that this particular momentum should continue right up to 1100. So long positions can still be added in MGL. The stop loss for the trade should be placed at 1030. And on the short side, the structure of Sun TV has been really weak. If you look at, the recent uptick, we saw some short covering led rally in most of the media stocks. But again, if you look at the cumulative outflows, I think again, they are dwelling more into their original primary trend, which is on the short side. So Sun TV, if you look at the overall data setup, 500 has been a mark wherein the call writers have been very adamant and they are still sitting on huge additions there. So I think that remains a very big hurdle for the stock. So the stop loss for the trade should be placed at 500, and a swing back to say around 460 can be seen in a couple of days. So short positions can be created in Sun TV with a stop loss around 500.
All right, Dharmesh Kant of India Nivesh Securities is also joining us on the show. But before that, let me just quickly go across to Amar to get his stock ideas for the day. Amar?
Yeah, the first stock to look at is Sun Pharma. What we are seeing in this particular stock is that the stock has been consolidating, and from almost 380 levels, it made a high of 450 and then again bounced back, corrected towards 400 odd levels, and is trading around 425, 26. Looking at the various time frames, what we see is that there is positive momentum in this stock. So this is one stock one can look at buying. So the range ideally is around 420 to 425. One can look at buying with a stop loss of 403 and a target of 458 in the short term. And the second stock to look at is MGL, Mahanagar Gas Limited. What we are seeing here in this stock is that the stock has been extremely strong on various time frames, and it has also had a breakout. And also what we've seen recently is that the stock is witnessing a significant positive and bullish momentum. So this is one stock one can look at. So ideally around the current levels, one can look at buying with a stop loss of 1003 and a target of 1145 in the short term.
Okay, those are some stock ideas from our technical experts. Let's go across to Dharmesh Kant, who's joining in as well. Dharmesh, what are you recommending right now in terms of which stocks to take exposure to?
Yeah, good afternoon. It's basically the financials which are looking attractive given the way the Q2 numbers have panned out. This is the only space where you have found top line growth in excess of 15% to 17% on the overall basket. And the asset quality has also remained quite stable and slippages were less. So what we think is public sector banks does offer a good bargain buy at as far as investments are concerned from the current levels. So Canara Bank is one stock which we have been pushing forward to our clients, and the stock has done well. We do expect that with the sale of Canfin Homes coming in the way, and then they have a private QIP placement, all this will give them a sufficient equity capital for the growth which is on the anvil. Valuations are quite low. It's trading at around 0.4x price to book value. 1 year forward multiples usually attracts 0.7 to 0.8x, so plenty of scope to go out there. The other from the same space is the housing finance segment, that is LIC Housing Finance, which again valuation comfort is there. At the same time, top line growth has been in excess of 15%. And with the lower borrowing cost and the affordable housing push by the Government of India and others, I mean, that is the segment where the entire traction is. And with this pan India reach, it also looks pretty attractive to us. So these are the two stocks where we find from the financial space can do well. Other than that, one can start dabbling in automobile stocks, maybe Hero MotoCorp after the recent correction, which we are seeing. It does value good value proposition for the investors to start in a staggered manner. So not much in the space, though the market is heating up towards 12,000 levels on the Nifty front. But if you see the texture of the market is getting narrower and narrower, with only the financials again leading to the new high. Others are lagging behind, and we did the aggregates of the number. So the picture was quite dismal. If you remove the financials, be it Nifty 50, Nexman 50 or top 500 market cap stocks, there was a revenue degrowth as well as operating profit degrowth. Even if you remove Bharti and Idea, then also the story remains the same. So one has to be very careful while selecting stocks and doing value investing.
All right. Okay. note those important flashes there on your screen. We'll get you more details with regard to Yes Bank. The stock's seen some bit of recovery from the lower levels. Rana Kapoor has completely exited the bank now. 0.8% stake, which was held by him, has also been sold. Nearly 2.04 crore shares have been sold by him. And this is a exchange notification which has just come by a while back. Rana Kapoor and his associate companies now own just 900 shares in Yes Bank. Shefali Malik will join us in some time to give us more details.
This actually comes on the back of that forced share sale that happened, and I believe it was Arnam that sold out of 100 million shares of Yes Bank. That was about 3.92% of total equity sometime at the start of October, and that's the time that the stock had plummeted about 20-odd% in a single day. Post that, you saw that recovery coming in and some conversations about fundraising activity and stuff like that. But now, I guess, now that you've got Rana Kapoor completely out of the picture.
Yep, and that was, I think, a major overhang till the time he still remained at least invested within the bank. And post, I think the stock had touched those levels of 28-30. The recovery that has come by, that was primarily also he exiting. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, the news coming in that they are in talks to raise $1.2 billion. Maybe that gets completed or not by the month of December, as indicated by management. Remember, they are in need of a lot of capital. That's the growth survival capital which the bank currently needs. But yeah, the stock has maintained these levels of 65 to 70 in the recent past.
Remember, we were still talking about how, while obviously this 1.2 billion that they are going to be raising is going to take their their CET capital requirements to about 10.5 to 11 odd percent, which will cover their regulatory capital of about 8.5 odd percent and give them that additional buffer for growth capital. But they'll still need more to keep going. The stock, it's somewhat been stagnated in this region after seeing that initial spurt and the excitement around that raising of capital. Around 7:05 in the morning, we were talking to Shrikant, and he said that if you have to purely look at it from a technical perspective, maybe there's some more headroom till about 75 odd. But that's going to probably take some time. But it looks like this particular kicker that's come in today's session, at least, and the news that we've got as to Rana Kapoor and all the associate companies exiting completely, could give it that fillip that it requires to take it and propel it towards that 70 plus marker. But we were talking about it, and Shefali is here with more details. Shefali.
Well, we just got it on exchanges a while back that Rana Kapoor has completely exited the stake and he sold the 2.04 crore shares now, which is about 0.8% stake. Remember, after a series of stake sales or invocation by various lenders, the stake had fallen to less than 1%. Remember, in October, Arnam invoked shares pledged by Kapoor against NCDs issued by Morgan Credits. That time, it had fallen to below 1%. And before, and that was the third such sale on September 19. Before that, Morgan Credit sold about 2.3% stake, and then Yes Capital as well offloaded about 1.82%. So after all these stake sales or invocation of pledged shares, the stake had fallen to below 1%, and now that 1% has almost come down to nil after now Kapoor has sold the remaining 2 crore shares. So that's about 0.8% stake. So that's almost the exit of Mr. Rana Kapoor after a very long journey that he had with Yes Bank.
Right, Shefali, thanks very much for that. And you can see the stock reacting to that. It's just gone one way, and now from being down, I think it was down closer to 2%. It's now in the green. It's up about 1% or so. Dharmesh, you want to give in quick thoughts on this? Yes, Bank?
Yeah, I think it's sentimental and good news for Yes Bank, because if this was an overhang where, new investors were shying away for investing into Yes Bank. So now I think the competition will be more heat up for as far as money is concerned to be deployed into Yes Bank as equity capital. So good news for Yes Bank on that count. And the issues regarding asset quality and all remains. So Rana Kapoor has now nothing to do with the asset quality which is there. But yeah, a positive news for Yes Bank, because new management, new people, and they should pull the bank out through. What Yes Bank was lacking as of now was not business, but was the equity capital to cater to the new growth coming out there. So this will provide them the much needed elbow room which they need now. My own sense is that going forward, as this QIP thing materializes, Yes Bank can likely touch 90 or 95 kind of a level, which will again be undervalued, but that should be the near-term target for Yes Bank.
Okay, that also depends on at what price do they raise money. Remember, the earlier talks have stated that they are in talks with a global investor, which would mean the dilution around the current levels, 1.2 billion, could be equity dilution in the range of 30 to 35%. But that also hinges on at what price will the QIP take place and at what price actually the bank goes ahead and raises that money. All right, moving away from Yes Bank, which is, of course, recovered from the lower levels of the day. Dharmesh, the other pocket which is active and which has been in news today has been the telcos. Bharti Airtel at 52-week high, recovery seen for Vodafone Idea, and both these companies, by the way, posting historic losses last week. But since the time the earnings have come by, we are only seeing stocks moving higher. What do you make of this whole development on a tariff hike, which is the first hike, by the way, from these incumbents in the last 3 years since the time Reliance Jio made a foray? Do you think that era of freebies is gone? And how much of a boost will this be going ahead in terms of financials?
See, I don't think that era of freebies will go away with this tariff hike which they have taken. And the story remains the same. Fundamentally, nothing changes out there. The stock prices may have shooted up, especially for Bharti Airtel. And my advice would be, if somebody is stuck in that stock, it's a time to book profit and get out of it. Because the business in the telecom space, the electronic business, is not going to give you better ARPUs. Going forward, it's going to decline. It's only, it will be more of a utility kind of a service with volume playing it out. And Jio will keep on, you know, getting more and more subscribers. So most of the subscribers already migrated to Jio from Vodafone Idea, and some of them from Bharti as well. So it will more be of a duopoly kind of environment going forward, and Jio will have an upper hand when compared to Bharti. So it's a right time to, you know, exit the space if one is getting stuck in Bharti. Vodafone Idea, I don't see they have a future. It may be a dead cat bounce, or, you know, a couple of rupees more they can go up. But the type of, you know, debt they are standing on, almost around 1,25,000 odd crores, is very difficult for any, you know, cash flow kind of a balance or margin to you know, service that. So that is in deep trouble. So exit both is my call on the stock.
Yeah, not convinced then with the move, exit both. But remember, the next important thing which most of the brokerages are also highlighting will be whether both these incumbents, they get any sort of relief from the government with regard to AGR dues and also payment towards the spectrum usage charges. So that remains key, because though they have made provision, but how that money will be paid, whether the government will be offering any sort of moratorium to them, that remains to be seen. And of course, Bharti indicated that there could be a consultation paper and pricing which could be floated soon. Let's see whether government interferes here or fixes any sort of floor price. This is something which we've never seen in the past, at least in the telecom sector. But let me quickly take a technical view, Sachdanand, on Bharti Airtel. I remember you were bullish on this stock when we last chatted a week or 10 days back. It's crossed the mark of 400. Would you advise now traders to book profits here?
Well, ideally, if you look at the overall structure, you know, the structure has seen a huge shift. In fact, the breakout that we have seen at around 400, you know, it is coupled with the impulsive characteristics. So definitely, if someone is a short-term trader and he has initiated or has rided on this particular move, it's a very good sign that, you know, one can take some profits off the table. But overall, if you look at the overall development, I think, you know, going forward, we may see this series of higher tops and higher bottoms continuing right up to, say, 464-455 zone. So definitely, you know, it's a very good candidate which can be accumulated. So any particular declines should be really healthy. So far as 400 on the lower side now holds on. So definitely on the bullish side. But as of now, since the stock has already rallied for 3 days, so it's a healthy time to book some profits and wait for declines again to accumulate the stock.
Okay, just stay on with us, gentlemen. Lots more to talk to you about, and we'll come back with the auto pocket. But let's get in a sense as to what the vehicle registrations have been in the month of October, which have seen a moderate pickup. However, the much-awaited relief that was pinned on the festive season has not come about. Vehicle registrations during the festive period saw a degrowth of 2%. So how are the trends looking like at the current juncture? Let's ask Vinkesh Gulati, the Vice President of FADA. Vinkesh, thanks very much for taking out the time. Let's talk about the month of October and the excitement around the festive season and how that actually translated into numbers.
So hi. So October had been a good month, and so we have seen growth of about after around 8 to 10 months of the degrowth happening. So overall, the growth had been at 4%, whereas passenger vehicle had seen a good growth of 11%. But obviously, all put together, commercial vehicle is still in a bad shape, and it's a grim situation. It's down 23% today.
What does it look like in terms of, if you were to, you know, keep in mind factors such as inventory, demand? Does it look like you could see, you know, any of these segments materially outperform compared to what they've done so far?
See, obviously, if you talk of last December till date, we have seen a degrowth of 5 to 10% or 12% in all the segments. Obviously, commercial CV was always more than 20%, which is continuing. So a passenger vehicle growth of October of 11% is a good expectation, good figure to see after a lot of degrowth. And this is the green shoot what we were looking at. And even if you see the data what we have shared of festive versus festive, so passenger vehicle has seen a very small growth, but it's a growth of 1%. If you talk about last year, 42 days of festive. So at least the market sentiment for a month or the festive period was good. But obviously, we are not looking at November with the same positivity.
Right.
We are expecting good sales to happen in November, but the figures would be not of a very good growth. It would be something similar to what an average month we do regularly.
Okay, but Vinkesh, also on the back of the fact that you know, you saw record discounts being pushed in by all of these auto majors, and that's the reason why you got the inventory getting cleared up a bit. Your inventory days have also come down a bit, and obviously, you know, talking to most market participants and market experts, they do believe that it was primarily on the back of these big discounts that much of the churn came about, and it could actually go back to being a little bit of a sore spot as we step into November, December.
See, actually, I agree. The huge discounts helped the market, the figures what you are seeing. And the current economy situation is not that great. And with the such huge discounts, we were able to arrest the degrowth. That's a good part. And going further, I expect, see, December is again a model change month for every year, good discounts. So I'm expecting these discounts to continue and maybe tweaked in positive for December. So another 1 or 2 months of good retails we are expecting this November and December.
Okay, it remains to be seen whether these discounts continue or not. Vinkesh, but you've highlighted inventory levels for PV are at reasonable levels. For two-wheelers have also come down. I think CV as a space has been struggling for the longest time. But tell us, halfway through November as well, what are the inventory levels now versus we had seen by the end of October?
So inventory levels are improving as of now, but the improvement is not that major. It's around a day or two which has improved since 15 days. And obviously now, in another 2 months, we'll be seeing that BS4, BS6 transition starting with some manufacturers launching the BS6 product. So the inventory I am expecting will be in control for another 2-3 months. Till the time the BS4, BS6 transition is done in the manufacturing part of the production.
Okay. But in number of days, Vinkesh, just a clarity, has it gone down or it just remained the same?
So obviously, October to September closing to October closing, passenger vehicle has gone down from 30 to 35 days to 25 to 30 days, which is a 5-day reduction. And then two-wheeler, it has gone down by 15 days. It's a good improvement in two-wheelers because we were really bothered for two-wheelers, and for the past 3-4 months, we were trying to request all OEMs for the two-wheeler segment to control. And going further, I am expecting there will be more improvement in inventory. Not very big, but another 2-3 days of improvement would be there.
Just one last question, since the industry is also approaching now the time of implementation of BS6 and of course CVs which have been struggling, do you foresee any sort of pre-buying to emerge for CVs before the implementation, also keeping in mind because they will become even more expensive post BS6 implementation?
No, CV, yes, I am expecting pre-buying happening because the gap of price of CV from BS4 to BS6 will be huge. But keeping the consideration the current scenario of the freight and the truck market, the things are not looking very, very positive. And so there are not a lot of fleet owners or the customers waiting for the discounts to come in. They're actually waiting for the freights and the business to go up. So it's just a mixed reaction. Obviously, the price gap would be huge, but the expectation from the customers to come in and buy a vehicle because of that price gap, there are some doubts because they have to earn. These are actually earning members from these. So that will be a bit difficult thing to predict as of today.
Okay, let's see whether that happens or not. Venkesh, we leave it at that. No, thanks a lot for joining us and taking us through your thoughts and also how the numbers transpired in the month of October. Dharmesh, before we thank you, a view on the auto space, would you be a buyer? Is it giving you valuation comfort? Because the numbers have not looked as attractive as one would have expected in the festive season. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think the numbers will continue to look dismal for this quarter and Q4 as well. So it's your time. I mean, 6 months it will take before the auto as a pack, you know, be it CV or MSCV or passenger vehicle or two-wheeler, three-wheeler segment will stabilize. So 6 months more to go. But usually, you know, market, you know, always goes ahead with the time because the numbers will come later, but stock prices start reacting earlier. So I do think it's a time to look at them on the valuation front and start, you know, accumulating them on a staggered manner approach. To start with, one should start with two-wheelers, and there I think Hero MotoCorp and TVS Motors. These are the two companies which look pretty attractive to me, given the type of, you know, products they are lined up and the price range and the type of traction they are having. Other than that, the rest of the pack, be it Maruti, M&M, Scots, or Mahindra, I've already spoken about Ashok Leyland, one should wait for them. So two-wheeler as a space looks pretty attractive to me. In a staggered buying manner approach, Hero MotoCorp and TVS are the picks which one should be accumulating.
All right, Dharmesh, we'll leave it at that. Thank you very much for joining us this afternoon. Markets are holding steady, about 11,921 on the Nifty, with the Nifty Bank up 200 points. We're going to take a very short break on that note. We'll be right back.
Welcome back. You're still watching Countdown with us, and markets have been holding on to the gains. Nifty is trading around the levels of 11,926, but I guess it's the Bank Nifty which is stealing the show today, and the PSU banking stocks have gone up. I just want to highlight a few stocks before we move on to the Fab Four stocks. Corporation Bank, of course, it's been doing well since the SR Steel verdict came about, so that's locked in upper circuit with 20% gain. But today is the day also for banks like Oriental Bank, which is up 19%. You've got Syndicate Bank, which has gained about 13%, and also something like Punjab and Sindh Bank. All these PSUs are doing pretty well, and the gains, as you can see, have come in just in the last half an hour or 45 minutes of trade. Punjab and Sindh locked in upper circuit with gains of 20%. All right, on that note, let's head across to Sharad Dubey and find out which are the Fab Four stock that feature in his list today. Hi, Sharad. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Navneet. The first stock is XLS Solutions. The stock is up more than 12%. Its highest level seen in almost 17 months. This is based on the news that the company's holding arm has been sold to Vista Equity Partners. So it's an exit for Wahlberg Pincus as well. But mind you, these transactions are subject to regulatory approvals. Up next we are having is Castrol India, which is up almost 6% after HSBC, you know, maintained its buy rating and hiked the target price to 165 rupees to 142 rupees. And also the slowdowns did hit the volumes, with the margins actually increased, and they expect and they're very bullish that the realizations will continue and the costs will be reduced, and also lower taxes has actually been a rationale for this upgrade. And next, we are having his Prestige Estate, which is up almost 2.6% after it has acquired 29% stake in DB Corporation's commercial project in BKC in Mumbai from Trinity Capital. Mind you, last month itself, Prestige entered into a 1,000 crore investment project with DB Group itself in Delhi's Aero City. And the last stock is Tata Elxsi, which is up almost 2.7% after we have seen a fresh longs of almost 26% and the volume trading at 2x its 20-day average. Back to you.
All right, Sharad, thanks very much for that. That was the Fab 4 stocks of the day. Keep those in mind. On to the chart of the day then. ITC and HUL are amongst the biggest consumer companies in India. ITC, which derives half its revenue from cigarettes, so also has a sizable personal care and food category now. But the story could not be as stark from the two players as far as their valuations are concerned. Agam Vakil's here with the details. Agam, over to you.
Well, so the discount between India's two largest consumer goods makers is highest in at least 13 years. ITC is currently trading at around 19 times its estimated 12-month forward price to earnings ratio. That's at a 65% discount to that of Hindustan Unilever's, according to the Bloomberg estimated forward PE, which currently stands at around 54 times, according to the Bloomberg data. For ITC, and of course, this is, data is available only from 2006 onwards. This could very well go well ever since the start of the trading for both these companies, for that matter. Now, according to brokerages CLSA and Kotak Institutional Equities, this is because of a potential for higher taxation on cigarettes and poor performance or relatively subdued performance for the nation's second largest fast-moving consumer goods company by market capitalization. Now, Credit Suisse, on the other hand, says that ITC has seen a derating despite the fact that they have seen an improving operational performance. The brokerage now expects the Cigarette Two Hotels conglomerate stock to outperform among its FMCG players over the next 12 months. That said, at this point in time, it is certainly going at a significant discount to a lot of its peers, certainly the largest against its closest one, Hindustan Unilever.
Thanks very much for that. Also, the fact that, the non-cigarette business is a very small portion of the total contribution to its overall revenues. Much of the focus still lies with cigarettes. But like Agam highlighted, that steep discount there's there. Whether or not that actually widens or contracts, we'll have to wait and watch. ITC, for that matter, in terms of, giving investor returns, has been a laggard of sorts within the pack and a slow mover, a sloth of kinds. 249 on the stock price right now, which is down about 0.5%. Let's also get in one more market voice. Joining us right now is G. Chokalingam with his views on the market. Choka, thanks very much for taking out the time. Let's talk about some of these telecom companies and your own assessment of how one should probably look at investing, if at all this is an opportunity.
I would rather suggest a booking profit in stocks like Airtel, which has moved up by 33% instead of buying them, because I believe it's going to be difficult for them to recover entire the loss on account of arrears through the tariff hike in the short to medium term. Even if they resort to that, the elasticity of demand will start working. I mean, there could be a demand slowdown for the voice call and data segment, and that could impact the overall profit. Well, of course, the long term looks very interesting, but in the short term, I think the proposed government thinking on helping them through tariff is already fairly discounted in the market. So one should wait for further clarity on this. And in the meanwhile, one should book profits in stocks like Airtel and Idea.
All right, we spoke to Rajiv Sharma in the morning as well, and he said that while what this does is it puts some money into the pockets. If you take a look at whether they're looking at a price increase in tariffs of about 12 to 15%, this will put about 4,000 crores into their pockets. But remember, their liabilities are huge in terms of their payment of the penalties there with regards to AGR. So even if they get And the positivity and the uptick will only come in a meaningful fashion if they get a moratorium or a little bit of a slack in terms of the repayment schedule of that huge chunk of money that they have to dole out, aside from the fact that they also have to pay for 4G spectrum and repayment of debt, all of those aspects need to be monitored before any sort of investment decisions into the telecom space.
Yeah, I think we need to wait and watch how Reliance Jio now responds to this one, though they've already taken a price hike of 12% recently in order to recover those interconnect usage charges. But that response, I think, will be keenly watched out by the street. We were talking about the PSU banks. I just want to pull up the performance of the Nifty PSU banking index in the last 1 month, how that's outperformed. Remember, Nifty Bank is up just 7% last 1 month. Of course, Bank Nifty has been outperforming Nifty as well, but the Nifty PSU banking index has gained about 15%. As you can see, all the constituents have given you returns. Allahabad Bank, of course, has remained flat, beat Indian Bank as well, but your gain is like SPI. Now, that's the most heavy-weighted stock within this index. That's up 22%. Central Bank, OBC, Syndicate, Bank of India, Union Bank, all of them have given you good returns. In fact, these stocks are active in today's trade as well. And such then, and if one were to look at the data when we were entering into the November series, for the first time after many months, the rollovers also for the PSU banks were looking good. So looking at the gains today and also in the last 1 month, is there any stock besides SBI not that one should look to buy within this space?
Well, definitely, I think the rollovers have been healthy, and if you look at most of the price structures, they have been more on the improving side. Even if you look at the PSU bank index, it is positioned right now at a breakout level. So definitely, if you look at the entire momentum flow, SBI remains the top topmost stock. But if you look at the structure of Canara Bank, I think that is one particular stock which has shown a lot of resilience, and now it has broken out from its resistance somewhere close to around 215. So we are expecting that it could rally right up to say 235, 230 kind of a zone where its 200-day exponential moving average is placed. So a stop loss for the trade should be placed at around 215 on a closing basis. I'm expecting that the breakout has been healthy, and probably we may see some follow-through momentum in the coming days. So Canara Bank would be the second bet when it comes to trading this particular rally through PSU banks.
Okay, Mr. Chokalingam, your thoughts on the PSU banking space. Of course, now the hopes of recoveries have increased post the SR Steel case. Are there any favorites according to you here?
Yeah, certainly I completely agree with you that some of these PSU banks are on the verge of resolving the issues in a significant manner. And in fact, the accretion to the net NPA is not substantial in the last 2-3 quarters for the PSU banks. And as you mentioned, SR Steel development is also a big positive. And most importantly, in the last couple of years, the new NPAs are not created. Almost 80% of the NPAs are inherited in the last 10 years. And therefore, going forward also, I don't see the stress being increased further for the PSU banks. Among all the PSU banks, I prefer Bank of Baroda. In fact, we have invested personally and also for our clients in Bank of Baroda, which is trading below adjusted book value, expected adjusted book value for the current year. I think, maybe in 6 months to 18 months, some of these larger PSU banks like Bank of Baroda would start once again commanding at least 30-40% premium over adjusted book value. So, which would mean a tremendous opportunity for creating alpha in stocks like Bank of Baroda in the next 6 to 18 months time itself.
Okay. Just stay on, gentlemen. We come right back to you and get in a sense on some other stocks as well. Get you some trading ideas, closing trading ideas as well. But in the meantime, let's also take a look at what dealing rooms are recommending this afternoon. Darshan Mehta and Yatin Mota are here with their channel checks. Darshan, let's start off with you first.
Yeah, so one of the stocks that's been spoken about is Max Financial. It's up almost 1%, but if you clearly see the move that's happened over the past 1 year, Max Financial, the stock is up 11% compared to anywhere between 50 to 70% move in the other private sector players like an SBI Life or an HDFC Life or an ICICI Prudential. So dealers believe that the counter already has run up over the past few days, but they believe that the catch-up rally will happen with the Max Financial. The other stock that dealers are talking about is Tata Chemicals, absolutely flattened trade, but at lower level, some of the domestic mutual funds are actively accumulating the counter, so that's something that we are watching out for. And Siemens will report its numbers today. It's up 1.5%.
but one of the very few companies among the large cap space which are yet to report the numbers. And dealers believe that this time around, Siemens probably will report a weak set of numbers. That's been spoken about, but Yatin has a few more stocks.
Darshan, Yes Bank is one stock. Of course, there was news surrounding that the erstwhile promoter Rana Kapoor has completely sold all the shares in the bank. Dealers, on the basis of technical trends, are indicating a sell today, buy tomorrow kind of a strategy. Almost 2.5% down for that, the stock at this point in time. As far as Glenmark is concerned, this is also one stock wherein dealers do indicate that after the recent rally, a lot of profit taking is happening in from the domestic funds who are sellers in trade today. And finally, Bank of Baroda is one stock wherein HNIs are said to be buyers in trade. And as you were mentioning before the link, the entire PSU banking index is strongly trading in trade today, almost at the day's high. So the PSU bank pack is doing extremely well for trade right now.
Right, Yatin, thanks very much for that. So, we are just talking about a few names that over the last 1 month and have given phenomenal returns. And one name is Corporation Bank. The stock skimmed returns of 85% in the last 1 month. Today, again, another 20% that adds on to those gains. Some profit taking, though, from a stock like MTNL, which in the last 1 month moved up 69%, but some money off the table today. So that stock's giving up 5%. ITD Cement is the other one, which has moved up 43% in the last 1 month, and today again is adding about 5-odd%. And then a stock which is giving up a little bit is Edelweiss, which has moved up 36% this month, has given up 5%, some profit taking off the table. And another name is Shipping Corporation of India, just going from strength to strength. That stock has seen no downside and is just on a one-way roll right now. In the last 1 month, 34-odd%. Today, another 5.5-odd%. Amar Singh, I actually want to come to you on a Shipping Corporation of India. Now that we've seen that the stock has moved up and it shows no sign of weakness, what does one do here? Take money off the table or wait for it to go up further? Because in the last 1 month, while it has done what it has done, the last 3 months it's done even better.
Yeah, I would say that Shipping Corporation of India, if we look at this stock, and the stock somewhere has a key resistance around 64, 65 odd levels. And also what we are seeing on the daily charts is that there is some sort of consolidation in the stock after the significant rally from almost 30 odd levels. So I would suggest that yes, definitely these are levels where one can look at booking profits, because only if it sustains above 64, 65 odd levels, then we could see the stock rallying towards 70, 72 odd levels.
Okay, that's Shipping Corporation. By the way, Bharti Infratel is up now 10 to 10.5%, and Reliance also seeing gains about 3 to 3.5%. Reliance is your top contributor. It's crossed the mark of 15. Amar, come here on Reliance. What do you think after today's move? Should you look to book profits or stay put with the long positions if anyone has?
No, I would say one should definitely hold on to Reliance, because Reliance, after a lot of consolidation over the last almost 8 to 10 trading sessions, it has breached that level of crucial resistance zone somewhere around 1480, 1490 levels. And so one should definitely hold on to the stock, because now the stock has formed very strong support somewhere around 1420 odd levels. So one should definitely hold on to the stock, and the next level for Reliance is somewhere around 1560, 65 odd levels in the short term.
Okay, we'll be watching out for those levels. And pull up Glenmark. Remember, this stock was in focus. It gained about 20 to 21% on one of the days. I think, yep, that was yesterday only. The stock was your top F&O gainer as well. Some short covering was seen on the future side when the stock gained about 21 to 22%. It's cooled off from those levels. Mr. Chokalingam, the increase was seen after the numbers. The stock was moving higher because the operating performance was better. But if you looked at the numbers closely, the net debt in the first half of this company had actually gone up. Of course, a lot hinges on now how they reduce the debt. They've been saying that they will be selling off certain assets in order to retire debt. But overall, do valuations give you that comfort to take any, to buy at these levels?
Oh, one can wait, because in a single day it moved up by 21%, without any major breaking development on fundamentals. So normally they give up a substantial portion in the short term, since it is not backed by any, overnight development. But so one can buy this stock Glenmark, maybe around 320, 330 level. But one has to keep in mind that across the world, including India, the high profit margin and high realization, those days are gone. and the valuation contraction has happened. But of course, it has happened beyond what one would have expected. But the fact is that they are not going to get back the kind of valuation multiple they enjoyed 3-4 years ago. So which means, you know, stocks like Glenmark or any other comparable pharma company at best may give only around 30-40% return from this. And beyond that, I doubt whether they can rise. So I would suggest buy on Glenmark in case it corrects, 5-10% from current level.
All right, before we go on to those closing ideas, Choka, I just want to come to you on ICICI Bank. While it's done what it's done on the back of, the readjustment on the MSCI index, there are a slew of brokerage reports which are pretty aggressive in terms of the target prices that they have put out. You've got Morgan Stanley, you've got Macquarie, aggressive to the point where you've got a level of 665 as a target price on ICICI Bank. Do you see it heading that way?
I doubt. I mean, after getting bitten down to below 300 1 year back, having this kind of upgrade, I doubt whether it can materialize. Of course, from current level, it can move up even 15-20%. As I mentioned earlier, things are getting better for the banking sector. And also, ICICI Bank subsidiary joint ventures have seen a phenomenal value unlocking. But at current prices, I prefer Axis Bank to ICICI Bank. I think there is a lot more stream left in Axis Bank with the recent mobilization of over 10,000 crore through QIP. Axis Bank should be in a better position to usher in faster growth. So therefore, I would suggest Axis instead of ICICI Bank.
Okay, let's get you those closing ideas then from our technical experts. Amar, coming to you first.
I would say one can look at Aurobindo Pharma from a short-term perspective on the buy side, because the stock had corrected and currently is trading around 430-32 odd levels. So one can look at this stock. On the upside, the stock has a potential to rally towards 455-460 levels, whereas the stop loss needs to be below 410 level.
Sachitanand, what about you?
Well, I'm looking at PVR. If you look at the overall structure, since last 3 weeks, the stock has been oscillating within a very narrow range. If you look at some of the volatility parameters, there's a very short-term squeeze which is being evident. In yesterday's session, we saw a bullish hammer formation, and if you look at the RSI, it has shown some amount of strength, though it is not sustaining above 50 as of now. But I'm hopeful that the level of around 1700 from where this swing has happened should hold on. So 1710 should be the stop loss for the trade for PVR, and I'm expecting a move towards 1800 in a day or so.
Okay, so those are your top closing strategies. Pull up Jindal Steel and Power. It's at day's low now. The stock's corrected nearly 4-5% in trade, and it is taking support around its 200-day moving average. Remember, this too has been one of the outperformers in last 1 month. Amar, on the charts, with today's fall taking support at 200-day moving average, would you create any fresh short or wait it out?
I would say that the stock has definitely run into stiff resistance, so I would say. And also, if I look at the monthly charts, it clearly shows that higher levels will be sold into. So I wouldn't be going into fresh long in this stock. And yes, if I were long, I would definitely look at booking profits, because the stock has got very strong resistance at higher levels.
Okay, if you've got longs in JSPL, Amar is suggesting to take money off the table right now in case if you're making any profit there. Mr. Chokalingam, before we thank you, do you have any stock advice for our viewers?
Yeah, I can share a couple of ideas. One is a Unichem Lab. I believe it's a phenomenal value stock. The cash is 55% of the market cap, and it exports more than 600 crore worth of formulation to US market. I believe in four products, they are the leader in the US in formulation generics. And management is also very good management. The second is Scient Limited. The stock is down almost 50% in the last 2 years. It is one of the cheapest mid-sized IT stocks, trading at less than 10 PE. And less than one time enterprise value to revenue. Most of these acquisitions in the mid-size IT space, starting from Polaris, Putney to last Emphasis, they all happened around 2 times or even 2.5 times enterprise value to revenue, whereas Mindtree is trading at 0.9 times. Like other companies, it is also debt-free. There is no pledging and a net cash company. So I firmly believe that in the next 2 years, Scient can create a substantial wealth for the investors. So all these stocks, we have also invested personally and also for our clients.
Okay, Mr. Chokalingam, we leave it at that note. Thanks a lot for joining us and giving us your top stock ideas as well. Pull up Idea. It's Vodafone Idea. It's up nearly 40%. And Bharti Airtel is up about 8 to 8.5%. Now, remember, Bharti has been seeing some bit of longs in the last three sessions. But Vodafone Idea, specifically on the futures side, there were a lot of shorts here. You are seeing short covering. But one more data point is, while these three stocks were moving high in last three sessions, there was the delivery data on the cash side for at least a Vodafone was in between 20 to 25%. For Bharti in the last two sessions was 18%. Now today's data, as what I can check, is between 40 to 45%, which is just giving you an indication today's move, which has come largely A on back of that news of tariff hike, is giving some bit of confidence, because this looks like more of cash-based buying, as your delivery data, anything above 25% is viewed as a positive sign and does not look like a speculative trading session. So, Sachdanand, would you advise traders who had long position in Bharti to book profit now or carry home the long positions?
Well, Bharti Airtel, as I said, one should have booked at least part profits, and the overall target that we are looking on the upside is around 455, which should be seen. So any declines will be healthy signs for the stock to accumulate, and definitely it should be more on the long side. When it comes to Bharti Infratel, I think that particular stock still has some more potential. So probably if someone wants to take a fresh trade, so 244 should be the stop loss for the trade, and I'm expecting that this particular move should continue right up to say 265-270 zone. So I think a fresh trade setup is healthier in Bharti Infratel.
In fact, we were just talking about this talk with Hemen yesterday, yeah. And he was not too very optimistic on taking a position in Bharti Airtel. But nonetheless, we have seen a big move that's already come into the stock without any material change in fundamentals. So, like Sachdanand said, it could probably be a prudent step to actually take some profits off the table for a Bharti. And even Chakri Lokpriya, when he spoke to him in the morning, he said telecom stocks right now are not an investment idea. They're a trading idea at best. They're not an investment idea.
But also, it's coming in anticipation. Yeah. They're waiting for government, I guess, to announce if they get any sort of relief or not. That's going to be a major, major trigger for both these incumbents.
All right, quickly, Amar Singh, Z, what would you do with the stock?
I would say that looking at Z, this is one stock which is trading sideways, and it's not able to sustain above the 300 mark, so I would rather stay away from the stock.
All right, gentlemen, stay on with us. We'll come back to you to get your closing thoughts, but let's start wrapping up the markets. So it's been a good day's trade. We have seen some movement inching up higher for the index, 11,957. So almost a 73-point gain on the Nifty 50, propelled higher by obviously banks and Reliance Industries, which has contributed the most in terms of points on the Nifty. 31,281 on the Nifty Bank. Sensex also gains about 240 points. Talking about the mid-caps and the small-caps, the broader market space, moving in tow with what the large cap index has been doing. It's up about 0.5% on the small cap index, while the mid cap index is up about 0.33%. Coming to individual contributors then on the Nifty, percentage wise in terms of what's moved, Bharti Infratel is the top gainer with 10.5% gains, followed by Bharti Airtel. Reliance Industries is up 3.5%. Axis, Grasim and Cipla are some of your bigger gainers. SBI continues to do well, so now that's moved I think closer to about 330 odd. Coming to the losers, your top losers include Yes Bank. After that initial spurt where it moved up into the green, that stock's back in the red. Z down 2.5%. M&M, TCS, Tata Steel looking weak, and autos give way in today's session as well. So you've got Hero MotoCorp, Tata Motors looking weak in today's trade. But broader market space, it's been a fair day for them too.
That's right, Davina. While you had the benchmarks moving higher, there were a lot of movers and losers too in the broader market. So let me begin with the telecom stocks. Vodafone Idea rallied as much as nearly 40%. We'll get the closing rates in a while, but the deliverable quantity seems to be on the higher side compared to the last two sessions when the stock was moving higher. So that's one stock I think we'll monitor even in tomorrow's session alongside Bharti Airtel. And also other companies like Tejas Network, I think right from the word go in the morning, this one too was locked in upper circuit with gains of 20%. So that too had a good session. And we've been discussing the PSU banking lot, where buying, renewed buying interest has actually come by. So you had stocks like Oriental Bank, Union Bank, Corporation Bank was locked in upper circuit. In fact, Corporation Bank, most of these banks, remember, they had exposure to SR Steel case. So the hopes of recoveries are pinning now, and probably the December quarter earnings could look better for most of them. Castrol India moved higher both. You did see long positions in the futures side. You had HSBC, which increased the target price to 165 owing to the margins that they posted in the September quarter. Despite a volume decline, the margins were intact. Manappuram Finance also trading around its all-time high levels, had a good session, 3.5% closing around the day's high mark. On the losing side, insurance companies were down today. So SBI Life, of course, on back of that block deal, Carlyle sold about 2.7% stake. ICICI Prudential saw some bit of profit booking in today's session. Bandhan, because of the unrest in Assam, they get their 18% AUM from there. Probably that was the reason why stock was down 4%. And interestingly, Prime Focus locked in lower circuit for the last 3 days now. And you also had Glenmark, which rallied 21% yesterday, saw some bit of cool off today, down about 4.5%.
All right, let's get to it then. This is what we've got in terms of the final tally on the benchmark index coming to the Nifty and then the Nifty Bank. Nifty Bank's up a whole percent, so that's good after seeing a fairly subdued trade in the last 10 days of trade. 11,957 on the Nifty 50, Sensex crossing 40,500. Coming to the broader market space, and we take a look at how individual stocks have contributed to the Nifty as well. For today's session, I believe it would be Reliance Industries that would have had the largest point contribution. Reliance Industries contributing 44 points to Nifty's total of about 122 points on the upside. Bharti Airtel following suit. Banks also, the other banks, and obviously because of the Nifty Bank and what it did. Losers include the likes of ICICI Banks and profit taking here, and TCS looked weak today.
Yep, I guess TCS was down for the third straight session. Some money being taken off the table here. Let's look at the market breadth then in terms of broader markets, whether the buying momentum continued there or not. Not actually, because in the last 2-3 days, we are seeing in the second half there is some selling pressure. And today also for the entire listed universe, the breadth was marginally in favor of the decline.
The gap keeps on narrowing. We've not really seen the big gap that we usually see.
So that theme of polarization continues. It's just handful of stocks which is taking Nifty higher, and mid-cap index continues to trade at a discount. But let's also take a look at participation, which was down yesterday. The turnover from the cash side was less, but I think it's picked up today. It could be owing to that block deal as well. So 42,000 on the NSE cash, and F&O has also picked up close to 10 lakh crores.
Better markers on both, actually. Yesterday, I think it was 7.5 lakhs for the F&O. But let's get in those closing comments from our technical experts. Amar Singh, I'll come to you first. What is it that you're going to be watching out for trade come tomorrow?
Yeah, I would say that both Nifty and Bank Nifty have closed positive, and technically looking at the charts, as I said earlier, both continue to be stronger with a positive bias. If you compare the two, Bank Nifty is stronger. On the upside for Nifty, 12,100 is going to be a crucial resistance zone, whereas support is somewhere around 11,800 levels. As far as Bank Nifty is concerned, 31,450-500 is an initial level of resistance, but it seems that that's likely to be taken out. So dips definitely should be used as buying opportunity.
Sajidanand, what about you?
Well, as we discussed, you know, the strength is primarily, very strong when it comes to Bank Nifty. But if you look at Nifty, you know, in the last half an hour, we saw it again taking support somewhere close to 11,900, and the recovery was really, really fast. So, you know, for tomorrow, I think this particular level will hold as a very key pivotal level for the indices to turn. But I think the way things are shaping up, and the way some of the leadership has been seen in today's session, probably we may see, you know, that this particular range that has been consistently providing some resistance on the higher side, which is around 11,980 kind of a zone. Probably that particular range would be challenged, and we may see Nifty, you know, scaling higher towards say 12,000 very soon. So 11,900 would be a key level for tomorrow's session. In case if we have a positive start, then I think that we may see very strong momentum play even in Nifty.
All right, we leave it at that, gentlemen. Thank you very much for joining us with your thoughts on the platform. All right, CSB Bank, formerly known as Catholic Syrian Bank, is all set to launch its initial public offering worth 410 crore rupees. The bank, controlled by Canadian insurance giant Fairfax, will use the funds from the listing to meet its future capital requirements. Advait Pillaipu caught up with CVR Rajendran, the bank's CEO, to discuss the bank's fundraising plans. Listen in and thanks for watching.
CSB Bank, formerly known as the Catholic Syrian Bank, is going to list its shares on the 22nd of November this month. The offer size is around 410 crores. We have the CEO of the bank, CVR Rajendran, with us, sir. Sir, could you just walk us through the issue size and sort of how much you're looking to invest to infuse into the company?
This is basically an offer for sale from the existing shareholders. As the Fairfax has invested recently, our capital adequacy is 22.12%, and we don't require additional capital at this point of time. There is a regulatory requirement that this bank should be listed before September 2019. So that is what we are trying to achieve now. This is basically an offer for sale, and only 24 lakh shares are offered from the bank side. So dilution will be much less from the bank side.
So just to understand, 2 years ago, Fairfax Holdings, Canadian investors, had infused about 12,000 crores, if I'm right, into the bank. This is the first time the RBI has allowed any acquisition of a bank of around 51%. Now, as part of this listing, the shareholding of Fairfax will have to come down. Could you walk us through the roadmap for that? And with this listing, how much does Fairfax's shareholding come down in the bank?
This is the first time anybody is permitted to acquire 51%. First ever time, neither before nor afterwards RBI has given that kind of permission. This is a rare privilege given to Fairfax. And Fairfax holding before this was 40.09. They have not acquired 41% actually because of a ESOP trust created at that point of time. The overall shareholding for Fairfax was 40.09. Because of a small dilution which is going to take place now, it will come down to 49.73%. They can hold on to it for the first 5 years, that is from the date of investment. And they have to bring it down to 40% over a period of 5 years. Over a period of 10 years, they have to bring it to 30%. Over a period of 15 years, they have to bring down to 15%, like any other investor.
So, sir, the existing shareholders that are going to exit would be several insurance companies also that the bank has tie-ups with for bank insurance. Those models still continue, those partnerships still continue after they exit with this.
These are all long-term strategic tie-ups. They are doing very good business with this bank. When they came in, when we were not able to raise capital in those days, they naturally supported us. Today they are exiting because they get a very good value. And these partnerships will continue for a long time to come.
So, sir, one of the points that you made in your presentation was that the bank has made additional provisions, the first of which is for employees, because several, the bank has now exited as the Indian Bank Association's wage negotiation. So could you walk us through the kind of additional provisions and how that sort of creates a sort of buffer on the price, just to offer our understanding?
See, we were having 3,000 employees on IBA settlement when I came in. Today the numbers have gone down to 1,900. Out of the 1,900, only 800 people are on the defined benefit plan, and remaining people are on the NPS provision. We already come out of the IBA wage negotiation. We are not given a mandate for IBA wage negotiation. We are not going to revise the employee salaries immediately, because our productivity is, when compared to the industry, it is much, much lower than the industry level productivity. So we have stipulated a condition with our employees that unless we reach the industry level productivity, we will not relook at the wage negotiation with them again. So for the time being, there won't be any wage increases for the employees.
But you made a provision for the for any employees?
Provision for the employees, for the leave salary, for the gratuity, for the pension. Our provision is much higher than the industry level projection. That is our internal policy. After Fairfax coming in, they wanted a higher provision to be made for this, which we have provided during the last 2 years.
So, sir, you know, it was a few years ago it was tougher for the bank to raise capital, so Fairfax's infusion has helped turn around the bank operationally. Also, you know, institutionally, you've created new verticals or you've transformed certain business practices. Could you just walk us through organization-wise how you've changed and how, you know, going forward, you look the bank to sort of project itself and transition to a more digital bank in today's day and age?
So before Fairfax coming, we were deprived of capital. We could not spend much on the technology. We were running with the existing technology. Today, after Fairfax coming in, we are investing quite a lot on the technology, basically on the surrounding technology around the CBS. So new technology, we have one of the best the mobile banking platform today. We are moving for a great account opening platform today. We have a good CRM system which is getting introduced. We have early warning system supplied by Crystal today, which is being integrated with our system. So we will continue to invest a lot on the technology. With the Fairfax coming in, one change which is happening is a great fallback which is available to us today. A person who can supply the any amount of capital which we require today. Having a market investor like this will help us increase your confidence levels. And from the old private sector model, which is a branch-based banking, we are moving to the verticalized model, which is a new private sector model. The transition is happening. It is halfway through. Some of the verticals are already settled. SME vertical is settled. Retail vertical is settled. The gold loan vertical is settled. The liability vertical is settled. There are a few more verticals, like recovery has to become a separate vertical. These things will settle down. Over a period of next 1 to 2 years, we'll become completely a verticalized model, like any other private sector bank. That is a major transition which is going to happen in the years to come.
So the bank has traditionally been based out of Kerala. 60% of your liabilities, the deposit franchise, comes from there. But you're looking to expand also the deposit as well as the advances side across the country, opening new branches. I think you've said over 400 branches is the target that you aim to create. So this will be distributed across the country. Are you looking at specific geographies?
So we'll be expanding initially only in the south and western parts of the country. And there is no fixed target for the branch opening. It will be done in a calibrated way depending upon the progress and the profitability of the branches. Most of the branches will be gold loan CASA focused branches, which ensures that it breaks even the first year itself. Then slowly you add the other products like MSME, microfinance to these branches. These are basically in the semi-urban and urban areas. Some of them in the rural areas. Metro focus will be much less because that is not the area where we are going to focus in the days to come.
Sir, on the advances book, the size of the advances book as of September 2019 was around 12,000 crores. This is below 12,000 crores. 33% of it is concentrated in gold loans, another 30% in about SMEs, and the remaining is corporate. What is the lending strategy? I know you will concentrate on gold loan and SMEs, but even in SMEs, you're looking to open up the segment to micro SMEs, for instance.
There is no fixed percentage in our strategy as such. Gold is our DNA, and we know the business much better, which is giving a good yield today, and NPAs are very low. And all my people know how to do gold business. And we are coming from the southern part of the country where the potential for gold loan is more. So gold loan will continue to be our focus and it continue to occupy a major proportion of my loan portfolio. But corporate portfolio, consciously, we may not increase it. We don't have the required skill set to do it. We don't participate in the consortium advances. Many of my SME accounts get elevated to the corporate. That is how my corporate segment happens. Otherwise, the focus will be on the SME segment where we have the required skill set to do the business. So we do what we know, what we can do.
The other banks across the system are going through the same thing where they are reducing their corporate lending and they're concentrating more on retail and SME. On the retail side, what would you be concentrating on? Obviously, gold loans is one aspect, but there are also credit cards and affordable housing is also a new segment that's where there's high demand for. So.
We don't have a credit card at this point of time. It requires a minimum clientele base, which we don't have today. So credit card is not an immediate product available with us. We'll be focusing on the LAP. We are relaunching the LAP. We have a two-wheeler division which is doing really well. And similarly, used car and used vehicle financing will be a new business which we'll start. MSME and microfinance will be the other retail products which will be launched.
So this last question, in terms of your outlook on the NPA cycle, I know your bank only has about 360 crores worth of NPAs as of September 19. Any concerns that the retail or the SME portfolio could see some delinquencies rise because of the economic slowdown?
We have slowed down on the SME and retail 2 years back. So we are focused only on the gold and corporate at that point of time. We have cleaned the SME book and retail book to a large extent. When we are relaunching the product, and we are launching it in such a way, the credit risk is taken care of. So I don't think that any more NPAs will come up in the retail and SME in a big way.
Thank you so much for speaking to Bloomberg Quint.